We're looking at Colossians. We're studying the reality of why should we be studying anything in the Bible? Why should we be looking at the scriptures or the Word of God and really care about what's happening in the Bible itself when there's so much happening all around us? The economy's going bad, or it seems to be limping along. Some people think that it's getting better. Some people think it's getting worse. When we see the nations that are arguing about peace, whether it be in the Middle East or in Africa or in Russia, as there are turmoils going on, or in Iran or in China or in Mongolia, there's places all around the world that really there's things that you don't know that are going on that you probably should know. There are things happening in our government, in our society, with your neighbor, in your own family, with your kids, maybe with your exes or with your in-laws or outlaws. There's a lot of things happening that are going on in the world that God knows and you don't. And I think that's what's interesting about this study in Colossians, is that we're going to find in this realization of who God is, what God is, and how he operates, the fact that God is in control. Oh, you may not think so because you look at the outward things, but God looks on the heart. God takes a long-term perspective on everything we see. He says it in this way, that a day is as 1,000 years and 1,000 years as a day, which doesn't mean literally that you take the book of Revelation or the book of creation in Genesis, the book of beginnings, and say, well, then if a day is as 1,000 years and 1,000 years as a day, then maybe we should go ahead and call the first day 1,000 years. No, that's not how Hebrew works. You see, in the book of Hebrews, as well as in any place that there's a discussion of Jewish culture, then you find expressions. You find the way people say things are colloquial. In other words, they have phrases that are meant to communicate ideas. And the reason why this is done is because in the original languages, in the original text and context of the Old Testament, most of what you're reading isn't done by way of written, but by way of spoken. A lot of the oral traditions are the fact of being orally spoken. And when you have communication, as you listen to a professional speaker, some of the things you don't hear them speak too often are things like but, and, well, because they've been trained to communicate in possibly a metered tempo. I know Chuck Smith has often been challenged by people listening to him and his tapes, now that he's passed away and gone on to be with the Lord, that he has a particular way of speaking slowly, supposedly, which I don't see it being slow, but that's a metered and a tempered way of communicating. That gives a person an opportunity to arrange and align their thinking process with their vocal processes. And the reason why we do this is because we're told that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So what's coming out of your mouth is who you are. So you might want to be careful about what comes out of your mouth, because the Bible says bluntly, things which come out of your mouth will both justify you and condemn you. So the reality of having a particular spoken way of having communication operate so that you could hear things is what God calls worship at times, and God calls music and singing, and has written the word in such a way that it can be communicated orally as well as written. And that's what the Spirit of God does for each and every one of us. Me personally, I happen to like the King James Bible because it speaks to me in a way that is melodic. It has a communicative way of speaking. That's why when we hear those words that a day is as 1,000 years and 1,000 years as a day, it isn't meant to be simply something that means that you translate a day of 24 hours to become 1,000 years, because bluntly, God said he put the stars in the sky, the sun and the moon, the planets in their orbit for seasons and for days and for times. In other words, God had already said why and what he made certain things for, so we can't contradict what God has already said by trying to make fit a day is as 1,000 years and 1,000 years as a day into something by calling creation day 1,000 years. It would be contrary to God's own nature. The fact of the matter is that a day is as 1,000 years and 1,000 years as a day is a perspective of when you are stepping outside of time. Time is irrelevant. Time is a dimension. Time is a concept that exists within parameters of which it can be defined. In other words, as long as you have an orbit, as long as you have stars in the sky, as long as you have the sun and the moon, as long as there's sunrise and sunset, according to the word of God, then God's promises are true and God will do what he said accordingly. But when you step outside of time, if you were able to get out of this physical universe into the spiritual dimension, time does not exist in the way that we define it. Time exists in the way that God is. And that's the reality of why a day is as 1,000 years and 1,000 years as a day. We find the phrase not contradictory, but explanatory of the reality of there being that dimension that's either the sixth or seventh dimension, if I understand it right, maybe the fifth dimension, that is time. Because there's space, there's depth, there's height, there's 3D. You've heard of the word 3D. Well, there's 4D. 4D is the time element, I believe. It might be 5D, but it's 4D. And there's up to, I think, 12 dimensions, but I'm not sure. I believe that it was Nachmanides that originally studied the book of Genesis and came up with how many dimensions there were before there was Einstein. A lot of people tend to think of Western culture and when it was identified in Western civilization as opposed to when maybe Jewish culture or other cultures identify things in the Eastern culture. Go figure. So we're looking at Colossians and we're trying to understand why would we want to understand or comprehend the Word of God, the Bible, in looking at it and wanting to read it for ourselves and study it for ourselves if in fact it's written to Colossians or written to someone else. The Word of God has been given to us for our instruction, for our learning, for our doctrine, for our reproof, for our corrections, for our ability to reprogram our mind, to cause us to understand in a way we would not have understood before the things of the Spirit. And because God is able to do that, we sit down at times and we ask ourselves, do we understand really what this book is and why we're getting together to study it? Do we understand really how come Colossians is given to us at a particular time and season like now for us to hear? Are those elements in our life, those times and places with which we meet or we greet one another, accidental? Or do they happen according to God's plan and God's purpose, exactly on time, in the way that he wants it to be done, as opposed to what we think is happening by circumstance? We find in Colossians oftentimes certain truths to be reiterated and taught us by doctrine and theology and ways of appreciating religion, because we all have a religion. Whether you admit it or not, religion brought you to a relationship with God, and God and you having a relationship is a religion. That is your personal religion. How you exemplify your faith and how you demonstrate it to the world may be your faith in action, which would be possibly a religious observance of your own making to do something in relationship to what God has told you to do. As you develop that personal relationship with God, then you begin to develop a personal religion of your own, a religious observance of your own, traditions of your own, a lifestyle choice of your own, a way and a pattern and a means with which to arrange your life so that you would come better into contact with God in a personal relationship. If you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus, you can't understand the Christian religion. It will be a false teaching to you, because often you'll find most of Christians in Christianity don't do what Christianity teaches. The majority are working on or being worked in or working with that with which Jesus said to do. Because that's the fact of the matter of the reality of what the Christian faith is the following and the exemplifying of doing what Jesus said in our life daily. And because that is what the Christian religion is, that's why we look at Colossians to find if we're acting like the Colossians, to find out if we're doing the same things they did. If in fact God isn't speaking to us, if we just change the name Colossians to Americans. And that's why we read the scriptures, why we study the scriptures, and why we apply the scriptures to our life. The Holy Spirit will give us the right time and the right place to understand that He's speaking to us about our life, not about the Colossians' life. So I exhort you and I encourage you, take personal what you read, take literal what you hear, take factual what you are understanding from the Spirit of God as He teaches you. Because these words were given to you in order to prepare you to go home to be with Jesus, to go to a place you have not yet been, to understand a person you've never met, and to be in right relationship with a God who is living and alive and not dead, but is going to come to judge the world and to pour out His wrath upon it very soon. You ought to make your life developed, encouraged, instructed, and discipled after what Jesus said to do. And so that's why we get together in order to look at Colossians. That's why we're going to read the Word and apply the Word and understand the Word as He chooses to give us the Word by His Spirit. So, Father, I pray that even now, as we examine Your Word, that as we understand Your Word, that as we realize that there's more to this written Word than meets the eye, I pray, O God, that You would reveal by Your Spirit, this is Jesus, literally. That in some way in heaven, when we see the physical Godhead, the Word itself alive and living in heaven, we will see Jesus, but we will see the Word of God. Because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So every word spoken, literally, is Jesus Himself speaking. And so God, I pray, show us Jesus today. Show us that we ought to be listening to what's being spoken and being written and being heard and being understood by Your Spirit to be those portions of this book from Colossians that fits our life, that the Spirit of God right now is beginning to teach us to honor our life as being turned over to You, as no longer we in charge, and no longer me in charge, and no longer others in charge, but rather, O God, I have given You my life, and I expect You to live it through me, that You would take my life, and I would take Your life, and You would live in me, and I live in You, as Jesus prayed we would do. So God, lead us this night, I pray, and this day, and every day help us to understand the way we should go. For we lift up to You our soul, and we expect You to perfect our spirit, that we would come to You one day, holy and acceptable, unreproachable and unblameable, spotless before You without blemish, that we would stand in Your presence and rejoice and sing with no fear of there being any guilt or any sin remaining within us or about us. So God, I pray, help us today to see You, to know You, and to walk with You in this Word. Amen. And in that, we're looking at Colossians 2. And in Colossians 2, we're reading from verse 6. As you have therefore received Jesus, or as you have therefore received Christ, Jesus the Lord, so walk you in Him. rooted and built up in him and established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the traditions of man, and after the rudiments of the world, and not after Jesus. For in Jesus dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power, in whom also you have been crucified, or you have been circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, in putting off the body of the sins of the flesh, and by the circumcision of Jesus. Buried with him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God who hath raised him from the dead. And you, being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of the ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Let no man therefore judge you in meat, or in drink, or in respect of a holy day, or of the new moon, or of the Sabbath days, for which are a shadow of the things to come, but the body of it is of Christ. Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up in his fleshy mind, and not holding the head, from which all the body by joints and hands, having nourishment ministered and knit together, increases with the increase of God. So let's stop there. The part we spoke of this morning was being caught up by the traditions. It was in verse 8 that we discussed, to beware of any man that would beguile you or to spoil you. Taking spoil was an old way of saying that you could get from someone their accumulated treasures, their wealth, and their possessions. They would be dispossessed of their possessions by way of conquering them. And often the armies in the Old Testament, as well as the armies in our present day, will go into a land and conquer it and dispossess it of its possessions. They will take unto themselves the spoils of war. And when we looked at verse 8 this morning, we were looking at beware, to be aware of and to be knowledgeable of, that these things happen. That all of these things that were going to be said after the word beware was like the word behold. To look at, to examine, to understand, and to comprehend. To see that where there's smoke, there's fire. To see that the possibility of there being some situation and circumstance of some frustration or some aggravations are going to come at you, then you need to be aware of that, or that you need to be aware of the things that were going to be told you in this verse, of the philosophy of the world and the philosophy of Americans today, of the philosophy of American Christianity, or the philosophy of modern Christendom, or the philosophy of humanism, or the philosophy of patriotism, or the philosophy of free enterprise, the philosophy of democracy, the philosophy of the Babylonian Empire, the philosophy of humanism, and the philosophy of manifested destiny. We examined some of those things that were able to spoil us, that would take us away from the knowledge of Jesus Christ, that would actually be taking that are not after Christ, is the expression, which means that they're not following Jesus. The philosophies of American Christianity aren't following Jesus. They don't treat Jesus as Lord. But rather, American Christianity pursues after life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. In God we trust. But it says to trust in the Lord with all your heart, Lean not to thine own understanding, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he'll direct your path. So if any man lack wisdom, he could ask of God, who upbraideth not, but giveth to all men liberally, that we would go to God, to ask of God, to be led by God, to be filled by God, to be taught by God, to walk with God, to know God. Otherwise, we would be following the philosophy of man. And that those are the rudiments of the world, that they want to say the Bible said, rather than God has said. And when God has said, we know what happens. Creation began when God spoke. And when Jesus came upon the scene, he changed everything so that there is no longer an excuse for any man to act as though they don't know what Jesus said. Everyone has heard, love your enemies, but not everyone acknowledges what God meant when he said, love your enemies. It's the same thing that we started in the beginning. A day is as 1,000 years, 1,000 years as a day. So some people run around saying that, well, no, the first day was 1,000 years long. And they misappropriate and misunderstand the scripture. The same thing is true when you look at what Jesus said. At the beginning of his beautiful teaching, which was a summation, it wasn't the only time he spoke it. Matthew, in the Sermon on the Mount, isn't the only time that God spoke those words. It would rather a phrase and a teaching that went on and on and on. For 3.5 years, he was teaching the sayings of Jesus, the teachings of the kingdom, the things that were going to be of his followers. This is the way. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for there's the kingdom of God. Blessed are those who persecute you for righteousness' sake, for yours, and on and on. I'm going to quote them all, but I can't remember them now. So, these things he said, and then at the end of his statement, he said, these sayings of mine, blessed are you if you do them, but if you don't do them, then you're like a man who built a household, that his house, once he builds it, is built upon sand, because it has nothing to stand upon. But if you build your life upon these sayings of mine, then I will tell you, you are like a man who built a house upon a rock, and when the circumstances of life, when the storms blew and everything came after it, it stood the test of time. It lasted. It could not be shaken. The fact of the matter is, anything that isn't after Jesus, as we look in verse 8, is after the world, after the rudiments of the world, after being spoiled, after philosophy, after vain deceit. They are the things that are not after Jesus. And that's what verse 8 we spoke of and read about and we studied this morning and looked at with such passion that we understood that we need to be very careful about the things we get involved in. There is a philosophy to football. There's a philosophy to sports. We should, what, win at all costs? No, that's not what it says in sports. We should be a team and we win. You know, winners win. But yet we see that if we want to win in monies, we have to get the contract. We have to be the one who's better than everyone else. We don't really think of it as being a team sport, but really it's a high sport. It's one that's about the vanity of vanities. And that's why Paul, when he wrote to the Colossians, said vain deceit. And oftentimes much of what's happening in America is vain deceit. Because we identified the three things that were obviously sin, the lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, pride of life, and then we turned it around and said, well, that's pretty easy to see in life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. When Jesus turned that upside down and said, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. And so the fact of the matter of our reality of our faith can be spoiled. You could wind up being caught up into this new theology of Americanisms that will take you into philosophy that will say the Bible said, the doctrine says, our worldview says, our religion says, and none of it will be after Jesus or what Jesus said. They'll explain what Jesus said. They'll tell you why you can't follow what Jesus said. And they won't be, as verse 8 says, after Christ. So starting again back at verse 6. And this, I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. And that's why we examine the scriptures. That's why we look at the word of God. We ask the Holy Spirit not to interpret it for us, but to help us to hear it, to help us to really grasp and take hold of that ability to understand the words themselves and the way they're being said, not because we need to look at the Greek, we don't. Not because we need to understand the Hebrew, we don't. We don't have to have anything more than the faith of a little child that if you tell them something, they believe it and they accept it. Just like you told them about Santa Claus. Did your child believe in Santa Claus? Oh yeah. Did your child believe in the tooth fairy? Oh yeah. Does your child believe in Jesus? Oh yeah. Well, what happened when you told your child about the tooth fairy, Santa Claus, and Jesus? Did you lie to them about Jesus? Or just tell the truth about Jesus and lie to them about Santa and the tooth fairy? We need to be very careful about the vain traditions, the vain deceits, and the rudiments of this world. Getting caught up in society will cause you to do things that will spoil your witness, that will cause you to be enticed and beguile you. The word beguile means to actually be confused. You're bewildered. You're beguiled because you have this guile that's been placed upon you. So interesting when you look at the word be, it's a simply of a noun phrase that means from the word I am, which is what God says, I am. He says, I am that I am, or I will be what I will be. And so you look back at verse 8 and it says, beware. And here we have beguile. And it says that men, lest any man should beguile you. And that beguiling has to occur through enticing words. The words themselves are meant to interest you, to get you motivated, to cause you to be one of those professional speakers who's able to say the right key words, to inspire rather than to cause you to maybe deny yourself. Because you won't hear a motivational speaker get up and say, hey, if you want to succeed, deny yourself. Jesus did, but he's not the motivational speaker, is he? After all, Jesus was the antithesis of what a motivational speaker is. He flat out did not build mega churches. He chastised his own followers at times, telling them things they didn't want to hear, yet they loved him for it. Because they knew that if they were told the truth would set them free, as Jesus said it would. And it did. They were set free when they discovered, hey, it's not about what I can get, but it's what I could give. If I give my life, then I will get my life back to me. If I give up these things that are possessing me, then God will take those possessions and use them accordingly. And he can better control the consequences of those things that are possessing me. That's the fact of the matter of whether you are God-made or man-made, whether you are led by the Spirit or led by yourself, whether you are walking in the Spirit or you're walking in the ways of the world. Are you beguiled? And you need to examine yourselves accordingly as the Word of God declares to find out if you're doing what Jesus said to do. You can look at the Word and make a religion out of it and make it dogmatic if you want to, or you could do like we said a few minutes ago. Ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened, because any man that asks is going to receive, because James 1:5 said that in the book of James, where he says, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who prays not. We say it over and over and over again because we're trying to reiterate and make the point of God said it. That's a fact, Jack. That means there's no retraction here. There's no detraction. There's no beguilement. You can ask God and God will speak. That's the point. The point is God will reveal his word to you if you ask him to. He will give you wisdom for every situation if you ask him to. He will lead you if you ask him to. He will save you if you ask him to. He will defend you if you ask him to. There is absolutely nothing that God has not promised you that he cannot do that he has promised he would. The fact of the matter is whether you will believe that or not. And the reality is 90% of Christians don't believe in a living God because they don't act like it. They think God is distant and far away. So they have to go out and protect themselves. They have to go out and hire someone. They have to go out and get things to protect themselves or deliver themselves or somehow find a solution that God never said to do. They are not following after Christ, as verse 8 says, following after Jesus. They're doing it the way of the world. And so, when we see that in verse 4, and this I say, lest any man beguile with enticing words, for though I be absent in the flesh, yet am I with you in the spirit, joying and beholding your order and steadfastness of your faith. As you have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, walk you in him. You see, Paul had heard that they weren't beguiled. These guys figured it out. They had seen the Roman way of doing things, and they said, no, I don't think so. So Paul was kind of thrilled with that, and we had spoken of that last week, and we wanted to reiterate that so that you'd understand in verse 6 why therefore have received Jesus Christ the Lord, so walk in him. Because they did understand. They did see what was going on. They did not become caught up into the political systems or the worldly systems or the monetary systems. But they were being tempted. They were being enticed, and Paul was warning them, beware, as he said in verse 8. It's going to come. And if you haven't been tempted, then look around and see if maybe you aren't already involved in. Are you teaching your children the art of self-defense? Did Jesus? I mean, you don't have to make your children like Jesus if you don't want to. But I could think of no better example of a father telling his son, well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter into your rest, when Jesus was told by his father, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. I would like to have God tell me, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. I would like to be like Jesus. I think that's what we're supposed to do with our children. Now, I know there are people that want to raise them in MMA. They want them to fight. They want them to hit. They want them to hurt. They want them to be tough. They want to roughen them up. I don't. People say, well, Jesus wasn't a mamby-pamby. No, he wasn't. He was a man under authority, and he knew how to respect that authority, and he submitted himself to God Almighty and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that if anything would have ever been necessary, God could have done it with 10,000 of his angels. Why would Jesus stand in front of Caesar, or Caesar stand in front of Pontius Pilate and say, hey, you can't do nothing. You know, there's nothing you can do to me that isn't given you authority to do to me, except it was given by my Father. I accept your authority, even as I tell people today, look, you can whine and you can complain and you can scream up and down and shout about the President of the United States, Barack Obama. But you know what? My Father gave me President Barack Obama so that I would submit myself under the authority that he was given him by God Almighty. And if you can't deal with that, you already have been caught up in the rudiments of the world. You are rebellious as a rebellious Christian, as a rebellious American Christian that this nation was founded upon. Rebellion. It was rebelling against authority at one time. And that's why the Declaration of Independence, if you read the last part of it, has all these self-justifying statements of why they're declaring independence. Stating to someone, well, this wasn't fair, so we didn't like it, so we did this. Stating to the world, I have news for you. This world is not our home. It is owned by and possessed by at one person who is in still ownership or possession of the world and its ways, and that's Satan. I am not a person of this world, nor am I planning on living in this world, but I am a citizen of heaven, and I'm planning on living in the universe. For the rest of my life, I will be existing in eternity with the Son, because I am following after Jesus, I'm following after Christ, and I'm being wary of and be aware of those philosophies of man, the rudiments of the world, and the things that are going to deceive us, possibly, or beguile us, or spoil us, so that we would not be caught up in our own vain deceit, but rather we would acknowledge that Jesus is Lord, and I am not. So, when you get caught up in your protest, your dissent, your variance, and your aggravations, are you doing what Jesus said? Did you ask him? Literally. Your Lord, did you ask him if you could go out and resist the government and fight it? Did you ask the Lord if you could fight for the government? Are you caught up in the ways of the world? Are you a violent person? Have you blood on your hands? In verse 7, it says, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. rooted and built up in Him is something very interesting, because if you put your roots down deep enough, you pull from the waters that are in the earth. There's moisture in the ground if you go into the earth and you kind of like uncover pits and things like that, and you get to look at root systems. They search out for and are sustained by the water. The rooted and built up in Him is that, how deep are you in Jesus? Are you rooted and built up in Jesus, meaning that do you know Him and are you following Him? Because if you're not, you're shallow. You have no root system that when the wind blows, it knocks you over. When the circumstances of life come, they knock off your branches or maybe even knock you over and you are stuck with your roots in the air. Maybe you were a great man of God and you got knocked over and your roots are way up in the air. Some trees that have been around for a long time, after they're knocked over, can still grow, because they'll have one or two roots that are deep enough that sustain them long enough that they will actually regrow and begin to grow again. So you have some weird kind of like plant life, but that's what God wants you to have if you are rooted and built up in Him. You have to know Jesus. That's who Him is and established in the faith. You have to know Jesus and you have to be rooted in your relationship in Him, so that as you grow in the faith, then you will develop your religion. You will develop that part of you that has been taught abounding therein with thanksgiving because of what God has done. You will know and see how God protects you. You will understand who God is. You will know what He's done for you. You will know how He's doing these things for you. And you will accomplish His purposes because you've given your life to Him. Because you are in the Son and you have seen what the Son has done. And because the Son has done it, you know that you can do it. Because He was human. You are human. You are sinful, but you've been forgiven. You've been given the same spirit with which you can cry out to your Father in heaven, Abba, but also that you could be dependent upon and know in a personal relationship every day what to do, what to say, how to be, where to live, how to go, and what to accomplish by way of asking God every day, literally, physically, to develop you, to teach you, to open your ears, to open your eyes, and to speak to you so that He could tell you, yes, no, don't go, be still, walk, turn to the right, turn to the left, repent, look up, look down, come up hither, come to Me, be at peace, fear not. Beware, in verse 8, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the traditions of men, and after the rudiments of the word, and not after Jesus. For in Him dwelleth the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Now, I can't imagine anything being there that blows my mind more than that word itself. The Godhead, first of all, is blowing my mind, because what's a Godhead? You picture this giant head, if you're like me. But the Godhead really means the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The three in one. How they can be in Jesus physically or bodily is a play on words, I know, by way of my own understanding. But I'm just saying, from it's the word itself, just the way it's written, like a child, it would be just pretty weird to say that. Okay, so the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are in Jesus bodily. Huh? Now, kids will accept that by being possession, but that's not what it's really meaning. It means that they are in and of themselves, as Jesus prayed, one in the Spirit and one in the Lord. We used to sing that song, we are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that our unity will one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father, and all praise to the Son, and all praise to Christ Jesus, God's only Son. And all praise God who makes us all one. And there's a lot of lines to that. But it was a spiritual truth of a reality of Colossians and a prayer that Jesus made in Matthew and John that really goes beyond our understanding. It is a dimensional fact that the Spirit's kingdom is in heaven, that the spiritual kingdom is in heaven. And that's a place where there are people who dwell bodily there, and that's one of them is Jesus. But For God to dwell bodily in this earth only is it done in Jesus. In him dwelleth the Godhead bodily. Jesus is the physical representation of God himself, meaning the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, all in one. And that blows up my mind. How he could be that and the Son of Man and the Son of God is just amazing. But that's what Paul is saying very clearly and leaves it at that. And he says, in order to really blow our minds, and you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. Because in Jesus is all the Godhead, that means, of course, he is the head of all principality and power. That would be like somebody telling me, why do I need a gun? And why do I have to go out and buy a gun to protect my wife, my kids, and everybody else from someone breaking in the house when in Jesus dwells all the power and principalities of the Godhead bodily? Am I a liar or am I a faithful servant unto the Lord Jesus Christ? Because that's where the rubber meets the road. Are you faithful and true? Do you have to have a gun? Or can you see what God will do? You see, I know in my life that I've lived my life according to that fact. And that 40 years later, I can say to every Christian, you don't need a gun. You need faith. If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, be thou removed and cast into the sea, and it would be done. But you don't even have faith to believe that you don't need a gun. You don't have faith to believe that God can protect you. You don't have faith to believe that God is inside you. You don't have faith to believe that God will take you home if you die, because you're more fearful of dying than you are of living. You're more fearful of dying or watching your loved ones die because you don't trust that they're saved and that you'll see them again in heaven. That this is hell and to get out of here would be a blessing, not a curse. So the reality of our faith comes into play when we determine whether or not we know that in him dwells the Godhead bodily, and that we are complete in him. We are perfect in him. We are after him. We are in him. We are with him. And he is after us, and he is with us, and he is in us. And that's why we are complete. We are made perfect already because of Jesus in us. Because he who has the Son, it says in 1 John, has life. But he who has not the Son of God has not life. Do you have life? Well, if Jesus is in you, you do. If you don't have the Son, you don't have life. You're knocking on the door. He's knocking on the door of your heart, as it says in the book of Revelation. And he's knocking on the outside, trying to get on the inside. If God is outside and you're telling me that the Bible says, and you're trying to put it in your head and interpret it, I can tell instantly by your words. Jesus isn't there, because you would tell me what Jesus said. Listen to your own mouth, and you'll know whether or not Jesus is in you. Very quickly. Write it down, your conversations for one day. You'll be shocked at what's inside you. And it might not be Jesus. And you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power, in whom also you are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, in putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Jesus. In other words, you have been cut off from the sins of the world. You have been cut off. Circumcision means to cut off. It's to cut off a portion of that member of your body that was the foreskin that was covering up, or was originally your covering for sin. Your circumcision or your foreskin is all you have between you and God, and baby, you were in sin. You were bound for hell because that's all you had left. And the foreskin is cut off in order to show a sign of devotion and show as a witness to the world that you have given your life to God. And so the circumcision that is made without hands is that with which God has cut you inside to the quick. Cut you to the heart, that has gotten inside of your heart and said, look, I'm cutting out the old stony heart, and I'm going to give you a new heart of flesh. I'm going to change what's inside so that it will come on the outside, and you will live out that with which I have done, which is to make you no longer of the world and no longer in sin, because of what I have done and I have been circumcised with. And that circumcision that we're talking about is made without hands. But it says in verse 13, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, has he quickened together with him, having forgiven all trespasses. So that circumcision with which God cut himself off, that foreskin that was cut off from God, that sin that was cut out of God himself, Jesus, was the Son of God dying on the cross for the sins of the world, that Jesus became sin, became all our sin, became all our trespasses, became all our iniquities, and God, the Father, cut him off. The circumcision of Jesus isn't pretty. It happened spiritually in the Garden of Gethsemane. There was a time and a place where Jesus knew what was going to happen. And, you know, he came into this world for that to happen. He trusted his Father implicitly, explicitly, but he had doubts and fears. It says that he learned obedience by the things that he suffered. It says that he learned patience and he learned lots of things that he did not know. So it wasn't like an automatic process that God came into the world and he knew it all. He didn't know it. He learned it. And as he learned, he trusted. And as he trusted, he became in relationship with our Father, as you can and as I can. But in the Garden of Gethsemane, what was coming forward was the cross. The circumcision of Jesus was to be that place where Jesus would finally show to the world what it meant to be a Christian, what it meant to be following God, the living God, what it meant and what it would cost you in order to be saved. And that was to say, not my will, but thy will be done. Have you been so circumcised that you've given up your will? Have you, likewise, as the Colossians did, given up the things of the world, the rudiments of the world, the philosophies of the world, and all of the world and its ways in order to follow after Jesus? Or are you following with Jesus into the world? Are you dragging him along, kicking and screaming to repent because you're in the world and Jesus is on the outside? Are you of that circumcision that was made without hands? That Jesus paid the price for all your sins, for all your trespasses, that died on the cross, that suffered being cut off from God so that you could live? That amazes me. That is what the circumcision of Jesus is. And you being dead in your sins, and you were guilty, waiting for death to happen, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all your trespasses. Imagine that. Blotting out the handwriting of the ordinances which was against you, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. All your sins, all your trespasses, all of those things that have been said that are contrary to our faith, that have been stopping us from having a personal relationship with God because of guilt and not following through with what God had said to do in the Old Testament, and all the ordinances of man in the New Testament that people have created in doctrines and dogmas and theologies and false ideas that they're trying to stop you in some way from being devoted to a personal living God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob who is real and not dead, keeping you from Jesus himself, all those things are nailed to his cross. So he says to you, come unto me. I took care of it. You will find rest for your soul. Let no man, therefore, judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of holy days or in new moons or in Sabbath days or in Christianity per se. You see, there's people that will tell you that you have to do, and they'll say what they think you have to do, whether it be read your Bible every day or, you know, 7 days out the word makes 1 week or whatever it may be. There are lots of rules and regulations that people say. It's not what Jesus said. Jesus never said, read your Bible every day. at all. Not once. He said, follow me. That's pretty simple. A little child could follow Jesus. Pretty easy. The fact of the reality of your relationship with God cannot be made into a religion that you could follow pragmatically and dogmatically, or make it into some kind of practical theology that you do every day, because then you will make it into something it is not. You will not be led by the Spirit of God, because it's not after Jesus and what he said, but it is after the rudiments of the world, the philosophies of man, and vain deceit. Because that is where Christianity fails over and over and over again, when it takes Jesus out of the equation. And it no longer says after Jesus or by Jesus statements, but it says after the Bible said. The Bible says in, and they'll tell you where it's at. They'll quote chapter and verse. They'll tell you the religious angle to Colossians, the religious angle to Paul speaking to the Gentiles, the religious angle of trying to make a church out of Gentiles that were heathens. Oh yeah, they'll tell you all that. But the one thing they won't tell you is what it says after Christ, after Jesus, that all these things have been done and you are complete in him. You are satisfied before God. If you have that relationship in God, do you have Jesus in you? Do you have, in fact, and have you received the blotting out of the handwriting of the ordinances that was against you, which was contrary to us and took from out of your way so that it was nailed to the cross, and having spoiled all the principalities and powers of Satan in this world and made a show of them, outrightly triumphing over them, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of holy days or in any other way, for it is a shadow of things to come and not the body of Christ. It's a smoke and mirrors. It's a shadow. But if you looked at Jesus and you put the light on Jesus and you focus on Jesus, now look around him, behind him, and you'll see a shadow behind him. And that's what these things are when people want you to read your Bible, or they want you to study, or they want you to go to church, or they want you to pray, or they want you to fast, or they want you to do these things. Don't. Take them one at a time. Take it simply. Say, I don't know. I don't want to be beguiled. I don't want to be caught up in the world. There's too many things that people have said to do that now I'm hearing, you know, well, you know, I could be a soldier and murder in the name of God. I can be a football player and crush my enemies, you know, and stomp on them and give them brain concussions and bruises and, you know, lose their limbs or even get knocked unconscious and permanently disabled or even die for the sake of sports. Is that a sport? I am taught that violence is a means with which a man asserts himself, and that that's what he should do in order to protect himself. So I say unto you this. Whatsoever the Lord tells you to do, that you should do. But don't be vain and don't be conceited and don't be beguiled, and beware of those things that are in the world and the philosophy of the world, because it is in Christianity today. We all have to, one by one, stand before Jesus. So if I'm going to stand before Jesus alone, I'm not going to ask you what I should do. I'm going to say, Jesus, what should I do? I'm not going to tell you that I sit here and I get, you know, great accolades or money or satisfaction from teaching the Word of God so that I do it because of what I get. I'm telling you this is what the reality is, and you need to deal with it, because I'm not going to be able to help you. There's nothing I can do on the day of salvation that hasn't already been given to you freely, that you could just simply accept, freely received and freely given, that God has taken care of in this portion of Scripture. He's already said that in him all of it dwells bodily, the Godhead, as well as all the accomplishments that were nailed to the cross of your sins. You are forgiven. Your trespasses are forgiven. You have been made perfect in Christ Jesus. Do you have Jesus? Do what he says. That's it. That's it in a nutshell. The bottom line of every single person living in life today is, Jesus has one question for you. Did you do the things I said? Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. Do you know Jesus? Then do what he said. Because if you don't, he already said what would happen. with the sheep and the goats. He literally cannot be compromised because they tried to compromise his words while he was living and alive in here. And it was recorded for us. You can't change what Jesus said. There's no misunderstanding anything Jesus spoke. There's no misunderstanding what you're being told today in this word and how you're hearing it. There is absolutely no one around you that's going to interpret it for you because the Spirit of God has already given you the truth. Now, if you want to lie to yourself, you can. If you want to be beguiled, you can be. If you want to be led away with enticing words, that's no problem. It will happen soon. But if you are aware of what's going on, then you will be after Jesus. And in verse 8 will be your key. You will not be after those other things, but you will be after Christ. You will be after him with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, with everything you got. You will want Jesus to be in you, and you will be after Jesus. And Jesus is always after you to turn your life around, to turn it upside down, to have him tell you what he wants you to do. Father, I thank you that you've given us your word. I thank you that, really, there is much out there in the world that's enticing. There's much in the world that's vain and full of vanity. There's a lot that looks good, feels good, sometimes even tastes good. Maybe it even sounds good. But you know, God, only one was called good, and that's you. So, Father, I don't know what these people might need to hear, except that you have already given them your Spirit. You've already circumcised them. You've already provided for them. You've already taken care of their sin. You've already blessed them with your word. Then I say, oh God, give them the power of your Holy Spirit to go forward in victory, not conquering Satan, not being some kind of vain demigod of their own religion, but rather, Jesus, I pray that upon them, they might receive the humility, the circumcision you had in the Garden of Gethsemane when you prayed, not my will, but thy will be done, O God. Father, hear our cry. Save us now. The world has changed us in so many ways that we don't even know we're being led astray. The beguilements of the false anointed and the false Christ and the many antichrists have gone out into the world and led us astray. There are many things out there that say they are the way, and yet they're not after Jesus. They don't seem to be after his words or the things he said or the things he did. And they're called Christian. And oh God, I pray, deliver us this day from those things that would lead us astray, because God, we don't want them. We want you. And so, look at what we read tonight. Be aware and beware of those things of the world and the philosophies and the rudiments and the vanities that are out there, because they're in us. I have them myself, and I root them and I fight them and I argue with them and I try to get them out of my life because they so easily involve my life. And yet, I don't want any of this life that's being lived, but I want the life that I now live in the flesh. I live by the will of the Son of God who died for me and gave himself for me, that I might be presented perfect and holy and acceptable before God my Father, that I might enter into my rest with joy, that I have done and employed all that I could with all that I had, with all that I am, to share with you the truth of who Jesus is so you would know Jesus in a personal, intimate way, that more than I do, more than I have ever known, and more than I've ever felt, and more than I've ever experienced, and more than I've ever heard audibly, physically, and known Jesus to be, I pray you would have in your life now and go forward from that moment, not to turn aside or to turn astray, as many have and many that followed Jesus did on that day when he told them that they would walk away. Oh God, I pray he help you to learn today that we serve the living God.